Hey friends, installing a service mesh can be daunting. It's big, it's scary, it's complicated. Or is it? William Morgan, maintainer of the open source project Linkerd, is here to show us how easy it is to run Linkerd on your AKS cluster and even use it to debug the behavior of your Kubernetes application. I'm learning how today on Azure Friday. Hey folks, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with William Morgan, who's going to make it easy to do a service mesh. This is a thing that would take weeks of my time, would it not?
That's right, normally.
But you can do it in a minute.
Well, we'll see. 60 seconds or less, maybe.
Okay,
maybe.
Or your money back.
Right, exactly. It's fantastic. Open source, so.
Okay, so why does a customer want a service mesh? Well, someone out there is thinking, you know, I need a thing.
Yep.
Service mesh is going to solve my problems.
Yeah. So service mesh is in this kind of unfortunate status now where there's a lot of hype around it and a lot of buzz, but it also feels very daunting to people.
Yeah.
It feels like it could be this giant piece of machinery that we're kind of levering onto our existing infrastructure. We've just learned about Kubernetes, we've just learned about Docker, we've just learned about the cloud-native landscape, and now there's this new thing that we have to deal with. And so what I want to show you is how Linkerd, which is an open source project that I'm a maintainer and contributor of, can actually make this very easy for you.
Hmm.
And I'm going to show you how on AKS you can install Linkerd in, we'll say 60 seconds, maybe.
Okay.
And
ish.
Then I'll show you some of the features that you can do with it.
And thereby the stack will become less scary and more welcoming.
That's right.
I love it. Let's do it.
Yep. So let's talk a little bit about what a service mesh is, because that's always kind of the first question we have to get to.
Mm-hmm.
So Linkerd itself, I said, is a service mesh. It's also a member project of the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, the same foundation that holds Kubernetes and Prometheus, a bunch of other very cool projects in the cloud native stack. Linkerd's been in production for years, and you know, we've got a very healthy community, lots of activity on GitHub. And I've put some fun demo material together, which I want to get into very, very eagerly. But what is Linkerd? What is a service mesh? Like, why does this thing even exist?
Mm-hmm.
And so the way I like to think about it is there's kind of three, there's the value prop and then there's the implementation.
Okay.
And the value prop kind of fits into these three categories. One of them is along the lines of visibility. So giving you visibility into what your microservices are doing when they're running on Kubernetes.
Okay.
The other value prop is around reliability. So when things start going wrong, which sometimes happens, can we automatically handle that? Can we repair the communication so that your application as a whole continues to function?
Mm-hmm.
And the third one is around security. Can we add security primitives in here so that we can make the system as a whole more secure? And in all three cases, the real value of the service mesh is that it takes that functionality out of the developers and out of the application and pushes it down to the underlying platform.
Okay, so let me see if I can understand this. So there was a time when I used to have to fly a consultant out to do round-robin load balancing. Then that became a checkbox in Azure.
Right.
And then scale out and scale up continues to become more and more abstracted away. Eventually, Kubernetes will become the operating system of the internet, and I will sit on top of it, and only people of a certain age will even remember that it existed. But it will run it all. You're saying you're going to take the best practices around visibility, reliability, security, and you're going to make them something that the developer worries less about.
That's right.
And
that's
almost an aspect-oriented programming thing. You're going to bake it into the infrastructure.
Yeah.
Almost as if it became a mesh.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And there's two reasons why we want to do that.
Uh-huh.
The first is so that the developers don't have to spend their brain power, you know, implementing retry logic and things like that.
Yeah.
The second is so that the platform owner, the same team who is bringing in Kubernetes into their ecosystem,
mm-hmm.
has control over these features, which are fundamentally platform features.
Interesting.
So that's the real value prop.
Very cool.
Okay, so that's kind of the theoretical exercise. I can talk a little bit about
it. I theoretically dig it, but I still want to be blown away in 60 seconds.
Right, okay, good. And so with Linkerd, you know, a big goal for us is to make it as easy as possible. So it should just work out of the box.
Awesome.
And it should have minimal resource requirements. It shouldn't require tons of CPU and memory.
Do I need another cluster to run that cluster?
Yeah, hopefully not.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent.
And you should understand what's happening. That's always the hardest part. Right. It does add things to your system, but we want to do it in such a way that you, as an operator, can actually understand what's happening.
Love it.
Those are the goals. If we can do that, then we've done a good job. Okay. So what I want to do now is I actually want to jump into the demo and then just show it off a bit And then we'll take a step back and talk more about what's actually happening under the hood.
All right, I like it.
So I'm going to start with my handy dandy AKS cluster. I have everything set up with kubectl. So if I do kubectl get nodes, we'll see I have a single node AKS cluster.
All right.
Okay, and this is a pretty empty Kubernetes cluster so far, nothing up my sleeve. The very first thing that I'm going to do is I'm actually going to install an application. So forget about the service mesh. Let's install an application.
All right.
And I'm going to install one that I call Emoji Bodo. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the way I'm doing this in true demo fashion is I'm going to curl this
directly
YAML manifest
from the internet
and I'm going to apply it straight to my cluster. Yeah, this is like the sudo, you know, install, whatever.
Yes.
And you can see that this manifest is creating a whole bunch of stuff. So that's good. It's got an Emoji Bodo namespace. It's creating a bunch of services and things. And in fact, I have my Kubernetes dashboard here. Let's just refresh this so we get everything. And we can see that if we drop down here, we've got an Emoji Bodo namespace. And this, everything is up and running. We've got a couple.
Age 24 seconds.
That's right.
Love it.
Yep. And we've got a couple services and deployments and pods. We actually have a little pod here called a bot. So a bot is actually going to be sending traffic through the system the whole time.
Cool.
Okay. And then if we look down at our services, we have this one called web service. This is actually provisioning an external IP address, so we'll be able to actually play around with this app.
All right.
And before I install the service mesh, I want to play around with the app because the app has a bug.
Uh-oh.
Okay. So what is happening right now? Let's go back, we'll hit refresh, and
get our external IP
there
address.
We are.
There.
External
nice
IP.
Done.
So if I click on this,
it's
we
real.
Will see our app. So here, I've deployed an emoji voting application to AKS.
What an attractive app with
Thank
a color-changing background.
So let's pick one. Do you want to pick one?
I like the cat with the hearts in his eyes.
Okay, love cat. All right. So
it's called Love Cat?
Well, I don't know. That's
okay.
What I called it.
I'm calling it Love Cat now.
And we can see the bot behind the scenes is picking a bunch of
oh, we're competing against
yes.
the bot? Well,
yeah,
that's unacceptable.
Right. That's right. Well, the bot is rate limited to one request per second.
Oh, we can
So as long as you can click fast in that, then man can defeat machine.
Excellent.
Okay. So let's go back. And then as I mentioned.
Oh, hang on. That donut's a 404.
That's right. That's right. So this app has a problem. We've hit a 404 page.
Okay.
Okay. Now the reason why I like to pick this app as a demo is if we go back to the Kubernetes dashboard, and I'm looking at the Emoji Voto namespace again, I'm going to refresh it just so we can see everything.
It looks healthy.
Everything looks fine. Everything's green, right? So why is it?
404 doesn't qualify as a bad enough error?
Well, sort of. Kubernetes doesn't
it wasn't
actually
a 500.
Understand anything about application level errors.
Uh-huh.
Right? That's not. It's not its scope. Kubernetes understands, and AKS will understand, hey, this pod crashed. Right? It'll understand, hey, there's a network partition. It'll understand, hey, this node died, and I need to provision another one. But it doesn't understand anything about the traffic that's happening between the services.
Mm.
And it doesn't understand anything about how the services are behaving. At that
right. It's not a business process host. Right. It's an application
right.
host.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. Okay. So that's kind of the setup for this. Now I'm going to do two things. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to finally install Linkerd. Okay. And I actually have this very nice command called Linkerd install. So right now it's Linkerd version is telling me I do not have Linkerd installed. So I'll do Linkerd install. And just like I did with the application manifest, I actually this is going to output a
it's
manifest.
It's going to output a YAML.
Yep. And I am going to apply that directly to the cluster. And what my AKS cluster is doing is it's going to set up, this is setting up the Linkerd control plane in a Linkerd namespace.
Mm-hmm.
You can see it's creating a bunch of cluster role bindings
We're
and things like that.
Prometheus.
Yeah, and let's go back to that same Kubernetes dashboard, because I like to be very visual about this. You can see that we are slowly bringing some stuff up. Don't worry about these scary-looking messages.
No, it's
everything's fine.
It's been 17
yep.
seconds. I'll
yep.
give you 13 more.
We actually have a very nice command line called Linkerd check, which will wait for these control plane pods to come up.
That's actually really nice.
Yeah. And while we're doing this,
so they're waking up. That's cool.
Let's take a look at what is happening here. So in that Linkerd namespace, we can see it's looking
sure.
a little more provisioned.
Yeah.
In that Linkerd namespace, you can see there's a bunch of different pods here. One's called Linkerd web, one's Linkerd identity, Linkerd controller. So different things are being spun up. The application, meanwhile, is running in the Emoji Voter namespace. It's
right.
continuing
they don't know
to
about
receive
each
traffic.
Other
That's right. That's right.
All right.
In fact, we can go back to the application and we can click around and
this is a donut related bug is what I'm hearing.
Well, right. Maybe this is like a subtle health.
Yeah,
message,
I don't know. Could be a could be a flake.
If you click on bacon, you know, we'll see.
that may or may not work.
Okay. So Linkerd check is telling me that the control plane is up and running.
All right.
Okay. So the Linkerd control plane is now installed. And in fact, we can run the Linkerd dashboard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And this will spin up my dashboard right here. And let me bump up the font. What you might notice here is that this looks similar to the Kubernetes dashboard.
It does. And you know about Emoji Voter. You're talking to Kubernetes. You're talking to your control plane is talking to theirs.
That's right. That's right. Now, Emoji Voter is still running. We haven't done anything with it. There's a second step we have to do here, which is we need to add the data plane to Emoji Voter. So right now, the two things are kind of independent, although Linkerd knows that Emoji Voter is there. If we click on this namespace here, it'll tell us, hey, we've got these pods here, but I don't actually know anything about what's happening there.
Right? Are you going to inject some bit of...
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. You've read the script ahead.
No, I've actually built large-scale systems.
All right.
The only way you could have done it.
Great. Okay. So the very last thing, before we inject Emoji Voto and start playing around with the app itself and see if we can debug that problem, I just wanted to point out that the Linkerd data plane actually runs as part of the control plane as well. Here are all the control plane components of Linkerd, and here is what we can see is their requests per second, their throughput.
Right.
We can look at their latency, P50, P95, P99. We actually have some fancy Grafana dashboards there too, which I'll show off.
You can see Prometheus is working.
Right, that's right. Okay, so here we are. Application's still broken, but now we have a chance for debugging what's going to happen here. All right, so now I'm going to go back, and I'm going to do,
we shall redeem
ourselves.
You
used the right word, you used inject. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to run a command called linkerd inject.
Are you serious?
That's right. Yeah, yeah.
Did not know that.
Yeah. Now, what linkerd inject is going to do is, so the control plane is kind of running off to the side.
I bet you I know what it's going to
do. Okay, let's hear
it. Okay, so you've got your original emoji voter, right? So you can go and you did a kube control or kubectl create, kubectl apply, you're going to do an imply because it's already there. Inject is going to see that YAML go by, add some stuff, instrumenting itself or injecting into that YAML. Yeah. And the YAML that comes out the other side will have linkerd involved.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
That is very clever.
That's
I like that.
That's right.
I
now,
like that.
Now, this, in practice, this is more of a demo workflow because this is doing that text transformation.
But someone who's going to do this formally would go and read the linkerd documentation. They would spend more than 60 seconds in doing this. Right. They would write the YAML custom for their needs.
Well, actually, we can do a little bit better. So in practice, we can do what's called auto-injection. Mm-hmm. So on the server side, in the Kubernetes cluster itself, we can say, hey, for this namespace, anytime someone deploys a pod, I want you to automatically inject the data.
Even better.
Then you have full control over everything.
I dig
but
it.
For demo purposes, we'll do this text transform.
Yep, injected.
We'll take the existing manifest.
Okay.
We'll do the text transform to add a bunch of stuff, and,
right.
I'll show you what that is.
Yep.
And then we'll reapply it to Kubernetes.
And I just saw you there in three deployments. You're now injected.
That's right.
Excellent.
Yep. And if we look back, let's go back to the Kubernetes dashboard, and let's go to the Emoji Voto, and we'll see something interesting that's happening here. Okay, so what Kubernetes is doing is it is rolling those deployments. Mm-hmm. So remember, the app is still running the entire time.
Yep.
The bot is running, it's sending traffic, and Kubernetes is rolling one pod at a time, and it's adding the Linkerd sidecar proxies.
So has it effectively versioned them? Any new version of those is coming up?
Yeah, effectively. And so if we look at this set of images now in our deployments, what we'll see is it's not just the original app, but it is actually something called Linkerd proxy and Linkerd init. These are all separate containers.
Is Linkerd proxying all traffic between all?
Yeah, that's right. Ah. That's right. So now, let me take a quick break to go back to this architecture diagram.
Excellent.
So let me show you what we've done here. Okay. So down here, this is all the control plane at the top, right? And different components, and they all talk to each other, and we actually don't have to worry too much about what's happening there. In the data plane, we've injected these proxies, and we have done we saw that proxy init container, what that does, that actually sets up IP tables rules so that all TCP traffic to and from the application pod automatically goes through the Linkerd proxy.
Mm-hmm.
So that way you don't have to do anything in the application itself.
Now, of course, as someone who's built big things, I'm thinking to myself, gosh, now more work is happening. So I would assume that Linkerd does its best to do as little as possible while still providing value, because if you do nothing, you can scale infinitely.
Yeah.
So Linkerd gets in and out in milliseconds.
That's right. That's right. So these Linkerd proxies are designed, they're actually written in a language called Rust, very cool systems language that gives you native code performance, but also gives you all sorts of memory guarantees. So you
Love
avoid
it.
A whole class of out of bounds, you know, security vulnerabilities
right.
and things like that.
All the stuff you would have if you were written in C.
That's right. Yep. Yep. But you get the performance of C, just without the kind of security question marks.
Lovely.
And so Linkerd proxy is custom written. It's incredibly small and lightweight. It's sitting at under 10 megs of memory per proxy.
Wow.
Less than 1 millisecond of P99 latency. Because Rust is manually has manual memory management, we can really fine tune the latency distribution of the proxy. All sorts of cool things. But
all right. Let's spike the ball in the end zone.
Right. You don't actually know any of that stuff happening,
no.
right?
You have to think about it.
Okay.
I dig it.
Okay. So let's go back to the dashboard here. Let me hit refresh, and we should see that everything is now in a happy state. So Kubernetes says, okay, everything has been rolled. The application continues to run. And the big difference now is when we go back to the Linkerd dashboard, we now start seeing traffic on the deployments and the pods of our application. So again, we haven't modified the application at all, but all of a sudden we see on a per deployment basis and a per pod basis, we see the success rate and the throughput and the latency distribution. Okay? And do you notice anything terrible?
Well, clearly you clicked on the donut on web called voting, and voting has a horrible 4 out of 5, even when it just got worse, success rate.
That's right. So let's take a look. Let's dive in here. So we can see immediately, gosh, this web service, which is actually fronting the traffic, has below 90% success rate. That's pretty bad. So let's deep dive in here.
Oh, nice application map there.
Yeah, that's right. So we can actually draw this application map from live traffic. So we don't have to introspect the code or anything like that.
So then it's happening in voting, and it's rolling the errors coming all the way back into VoteBot.
That's right. That's right. So this web service, which is the one we're looking in, talks to two other services, voting and emoji.
Yeah.
Emoji seems to be fine,
yeah.
but voting is failing. Okay, so let's click on that one. Okay, and this is a pretty straightforward. This only has one client, which is a web service. Terrible success rate. And down here, we can actually see a live set of calls. This is a sampled set of calls. Now this application is gRPC, so we've got these funny looking paths and everything is a post. But we can see everything here looks good except this one call here, vote donut, which seems to be failing. So out of those three calls that we sampled so far, they have all failed. And we can take this one step further and we can
look at this tool. Someone is trying to mess up the election.
Yeah, that's right. We can look at this cool tool called Tap, which will actually show me just a pure sample. In this case, I've configured it to show me all requests that are going to the voting service, one at a time. And we can see, let me actually pause it, because we've got a lot of requests now. We can see that most of them have gRPC status OK. Some of them have gRPC status unknown, which effectively means error. And those ones that have unknown are vote donut.
All right. Well, we're just about out of time here. Let's dig into donut real quick and see why it's broken.
Well, so at that point, that's when it becomes a developer question, right?
Ah.
The code in here is
have you just punted to the developer
that's
team
right.
now?
That's right. But
so we know what's wrong, and we tell the developers go fix it.
Rather than saying, hey, the app is broken, I don't understand what's happening, you can say, hey, this specific call on this specific service is now failing. So can you see where the bug is there? So that's an example of how you can use Linkerd's observability and telemetry features to debug a live application.
I love it. And the bad part about this is that I'm never going to know why the donut fails. I'm going to have to go and look at the source code
for Emoji Voto,
and you can too.
That's
What's great about this is that you can go and put together a service mesh with Linkerd and AKS in no time at all. Thank you so much for spending time with us.
It was my pleasure.
All right, we're learning about service mesh and Linkerd today on Azure Friday.